All right, so it's an immense pleasure to introduce a great mathematician, great humanitarian from Moscow, Mr. Derived Categories, and a friend of mine for many, many years, Dima Orlov. Dima?
So thank you very much for introducing to give a talk. And so it's my first talk in Zoom, so something maybe will be a little bit wrong, so I'm sorry about it. If everything happens, so and today I'm going to talk about finite-dimensional differential gradient algebra and their properties. So, and so the main goal of this talk is to try to describe the world of derived noncommutative schemes that are related to finite-dimensional differential gradient K algebras. So the main thing here is that these differential gradient K algebras are finite dimensional. So it's the main thing here. And of course, we fix a base field. And the plan of my talk is following. So at first, I need to say a few words about differential gradient algebras and models, of course. Sorry if everybody knows about it. So after that, I will say a few words about derived non-commutative schemes. It's more or less the same as the first differential gradient algebras and their properties. Some properties I recall some properties. And after that, I'm going to talk about gluing of derived non-commutative schemes. It's a special thing that is just can happen only for derived non-commutative schemes, so it doesn't exist in commutative case. And also, I'm going to talk about gluing of finite dimensional differential gradient algebras. It's a particular case. After that, I'm going to say a few words. And in some sense, it's a main, so I mean that it's a main part for doing everything after that. The main tool, so to talk about radicals for finite dimensional differential gradient algebras and about what is the semi-simplicity or semi-simplicity for finite dimensional differential gradient algebras. After that, I give some kind of generalization of Ausländer construction for finite dimensional differential gradient algebra. So I mean the generalization because Ausländer construction, so it's some construction for finite dimensional algebra. So now I would like to talk about how it goes for differential gradient algebras. And after that, it will be some application of this Ausländer construction and the main so things here, so it will be description of derived non-commutative schemes for finite dimensional differential gradient algebras. And after that, I will going to say, I hope I have time to say about it, so about geometric realizations for finite dimensional differential gradient algebras and about geometric descriptions of derived non-commutative schemes for finite dimensional differential gradient algebras. And finally, again, if I will have a time, so I give briefly two examples I consider. So let us start actually. And at first thing that it's just few words. What is a differential gradient algebra? Of course, I think that everybody knows, but sorry, I just briefly say, so it's what is differential gradient algebra? It's a Z gradient algebra, of course, and also with a differential. So this means that it's some map of degree one, D square is equal to zero. And also we have a Leibniz rule that is written here. And it gives us a definition, it's complete definition of differential gradient algebra. And of course, usual algebra is a differential gradient. We can consider differential equals zero and the gradient, trivial gradient, so everything in degree zero. So, and the differential gradient modulus again, it's directly goes, so it's just a gradient modulus over gradient algebra, again with differential, and again it's degree one square is equal to zero, and again Leibniz rule holds, but here we see that we have a multiplication on the elements of algebra, so here M is from M and R from differential element of differential gradient algebra R. And after that, if you have a two DG models, differential graded models, we can consider homes between them. But at first, we can consider homes as a big home. So I mean that is a complex, actually, of homes between these models, not a vector space, but a complex. And this complex is defined in the following way. So as a gradient vector space, it's just a direct sum of homes of homogeneous map between these models as a gradient models of degree Q, by all Q, of course. And after that, we have a differential, natural differential acting here. It looks like here. So such way we get a complex, actually, homes between differential gradient models. It's just a complex of vector spaces. It's important for us, so we will consider, after that, we will consider not a category of DG models, but we will consider so-called DG category of DG models. So this means that, again, by definition, more or less a DG category, it means that the homes, so it's enhancement, so there is some kind of so homes between objects, not a vector spaces, but complexes of vector spaces. So it's here. So let us denote by mod R the DG category of right DG models. So it's exactly that I said. So I mean that the homes now between DG models are complexes that I defined above. And of course, we can consider subcategory here that consists of a cyclic DG model. So what means a cyclic DG model? So you remember that DG models, it's a gradient models with differential. And of course, for if we have a differential, we can consider cohomology. And if we have all cohomology are trivial, then this DG model is called a cyclic, as usual. And after that, we can define derived category of all models over this DG algebra R is defined the following way. So what is written here? So here we consider if we have a DG category like mod R, it's a DG category, homes are complexes. But if you have a DG category, you can consider homotopy category. So just consider, so we have a complex of morphisms, but if we take for each complex, we can take the zero cohomology of this complex. It will be it give us a homotopy category. And after that, we have a quotient of homotopy category, but homotopy, it's a triangulated actually category. And this is triangulated subcategory. We can consider quotient, and we just obtain the usual definition of derived category of all DG modules over R. And again, DG model is called free as a usual thing that it's isomorphic to a direct sum of the R up to shift. So shifted R. And DG model is called semi-free if it has a filtration. It can be infinite filtration here with a free quotient. So all quotients are the just the free models. And the full DG subcategory of semi-free DG modules, let us denote by SFR. And now we have inclusion. So we have inclusion of semi-free modules to all modules. And it's a nice thing here. It's exactly why we consider semi-free modules and so on, so on, that it's give us that homotopy category of these semi-free modules. It's exactly the derived category. So it's an usual thing. So we just consider the projective resolutions if you want for in general stuff. So semi-free is just projective resolution. So it's a nice property. And after that, of course, we also can consider subcategory special semi-free modules that are finitely generated. So what means finitely generated semi-free? Look, we have here the filtration. If this filtration is finite, so this means that it's Fn is equal to just the whole P. It's a first property. And after that, the all quotients are a finite direct sums of Rm. So this means that it's a finitely generated semi-free DG models. Nice. And now the main definition here, the DG category of perfect models. What is a perfect model? So perfect model is as such, what is the DG category of perfect models? It's a, of course, it's a semi-free model. So, okay, I'll say a little bit later, some maybe correction. So anyway, so it's a semi-free model that consists of all DG models that are homotopy equivalent to the direct summons of semi-free models of finitely generated semi-free models. So of course, all finitely generated semi-free models are here inside the perfect models. But also, we take all direct summons, but direct summons in not in differential gradient category, but direct summons in homotopy category, direct summons. So it gives us this definition, but of course, a more reasonable consider here not semi-free models, but so-called H-projective or homotopy projective models. It's better, but I don't want to say it's here. So anyway, so this definition is enough. And the homotopy category, so this is DG, full DG subcategory here. And homotopy category of this DG category is denoted by just the perf R, the small p here. And it's equivalent to triangulated subcategory of compact objects in our big derived category. So we have a big derived category, and here we have a subcategory of compact object. What is a subcategory of compact object? I didn't write the definition here, but I just say so. It's a such object that homes to all direct sums, commute with direct sums, commute. So of course, any commutes with a finite direct sum, but here it's important that to all direct sums, so it's complete. It's exactly compact object. And it's some kind of miracle, so we have that the perfect model that I defined by another way is actually exactly the category of compact objects here. So it can be defined in internal terms of derived category of all models. So it's some kind of preliminary here. And after that, we go to the derived non-commutative schemes and their properties. So what is a derived non-commutative schemes for me? So derived non-commutative scheme, it's just a DG category of the such form. So DG category of the form, the perfect modus over some DG algebra R, and where DG algebra R is actually, I ask it that it's homologically bounded, differential gradient algebra. So some people just say that cohomologically bounded maybe not right thing, so they consider all DG algebras. Okay, if you want, you can, but I consider cohomologically bounded DG algebras. So reason, no reasons here. So at first, some kind of definitions, a category of triangulated category of perf R, that is homotopy category of this DG category, is called the category of perfect complexes on this derived non-commutative scheme X, while the derived category R is called the derived category of quasi-coherent sheaves on this derived non-commutative schemes. It's just a definition. And the reason of this definition is following, just words about it. So if X is quasi-compact and quasi-separated scheme, usual commutative, then we can consider the also the DG category of perfect complexes over X. X, it's easy to define. And this category is actually quasi-equivalent to the category of perf R, where R is cohomologically bounded DG algebra R, DG algebra. And these results go to Niemann for separated schemes and Bondel van der Berg for quasi-separated scheme. But I mean that ID is going to Niemann, of course. And they are cohomologically bounded. It's the reason why I also use a cohomologically bounded. And of course, I have to say that such a presentation, so there are different DG algebras that give the same DG different DG algebras that give the same DG category, perf R. So this is a reason why here the derived non-commutative scheme not R, but perf R. So there are a lot of different R that give the same quasi-equivalent perf R. And they are called Marita equivalent, if you want, or DG Marita equivalent, nevertheless. So. And the main thing here, it's a B's DG category, not algebra. So And now, so few important properties here. So at first, we know what is a proper. When you say that our derived non-commutative scheme is proper, if actually one is definition that is not, in some sense, formally is not Marita invariant, but anyway, so it's easy to say that it's if you consider cohomology of PSDG algebra R and consider all cohomologies, so direct sums, that it's a finite dimensional, just over K. So, but it's property of course this category, not the property of algebra. If you take another, so actually it can be defined of course in terms of this category, and even not in the terms of DG category, but in terms of triangulated category of perfect complex so far. It just to say that Holmes between any two objects, sum of Holmes with shift, so will be finite dimensional vector spaces. So it's a first thing, and another thing, it's a smoothness. So derived non-commutative scheme is called K-smooth. It's important K here because it depends on K. If the differential gradient algebra R is perfect as a DG bimodal, so it means that it's a perfect as a model over this DG algebra, and you see the tensor product over K, so it's a, it depends on K. And here it's not trivial, but it exists that actually smoothness is Marita invariant, so it's proved Lunds and Schnurrer, that it's just a property of this DG category perf R. So it doesn't depend on R, but it's the property of the whole category. It's important here. And moreover, notions of smoothness and properness are compatible with the corresponding notions for commutative separated scheme of finite time. So that's all what I want to say at this moment here. That just to say that it's not something strange. It's exactly compatible with the usual notion. And thus, what we have. So if you consider finite dimensional differential gradient algebra, it's a main object of my talk, then it's proper differential derived non-commutative scheme. So it's proper, just because it's finite dimensional. So I mean that cohomology is also finite dimensional. So this means that I have a special, of course, there are a lot of proper usual schemes and derived non-commutative schemes that are not related to finite dimensional DG algebras. And we'll see it's easy later. But I mean that I consider now the special proper derived non-commutative schemes that are related exactly to the finite dimensional differential gradient algebras. So, and at first thing that about what this means that this, so we have a finite dimensional differential gradient algebra R and consider this non-commutative scheme. So we consider just a differential gradient category perf R. And now we can ask, is it property of this category that this algebra is finite dimensional? Yes, it's a property of also this, just property of this category. What I mean? I mean that there is a following proposition. That if you consider the finite dimensional differential gradient algebra, and if you consider any perfect DG module, and after that we can consider differential gradient algebra of endomorphisms of this differential gradient module perfect. So this differential gradient algebra is actually quasi-isomorphic to finite dimensional differential gradient algebra. So the easy corollary from here is exactly Marita equivalent. So if we have two differential gradient algebras and categories perf R1 is quasi equivalent to the category perf R2, and suppose that R1 is quasi isomorphic to finite dimensional DG algebra, then R2 is also quasi isomorphic to finite dimensional differential gradient algebra. So this is exactly what I want to say, what is Marita equivalent invariant about this property is Marita invariant. What is the simplest differential derived non-commutative schemes? The simplest derived non-commutative schemes, of course, as in commutative algebra, it's a field. But of course, here we have not only commutative field, but non-commutative. So the simplest examples are finite-dimensional division algebras, or a more generally, semi-simple algebras. Just semi-simple algebras is the simplest example of derived non-commutative schemes. And the main thing here that we have some kind of gluing procedure for derived non-commutative schemes. And taking the simplest derived non-commutative schemes like division algebras, then we can construct a lot of new derived and not simple actually derived non-commutative schemes. And before to say definition, I just have to recall some definition of semi-exceptional collection. So let me remind. So an object E in triangulated category T is called semi-exceptional if all X from this object to itself is zero, if L is not equal zero. And usual form are just simply a finite dimensional semi-simple algebra. So in this, if this semi-simple algebra is just a field K, it's called exceptional. But here I call it semi-exceptional because it's semi-simple algebra, and of course also division algebra can be here, or matrix or algebra over or some kind of finite field extension. So everything is here. And semi-exceptional collection is a sequence of such semi-exceptional objects with, of course, some kind of semi-orthogonality conditions that all homes from EI to EJ is equal zero if I bigger than J. So everybody doesn't know about it. And the collection is called full if it generated the whole triangulated category T. What means that generated means that the smallest triangulated subcategory that contains all these objects here, that it's coincided with the whole category T. So it's again standard. So it's kind of remind of definition. And now, what about the gluing? Gluing of DG algebra. So suppose we have of course we can glue DG categories, but I am talking about DG algebras, and it's simpler to say just what is a gluing of DG algebras. So let R and S be two DG algebras, and let T be some kind of bimodal. And first we can define the so-called low triangle DG algebra R, S, and T here is defined as following. So it's it's the best way to write it in the V's matrix form. And after that, everybody understands how it looks. So I mean that how looks multiplication here. And so this is a definition. And after that, the gluing of two non-commutative scheme X and Y, and we X is the perfect modulus over R and Y is the perfect modulus over S with respect to DG bimodal T is DG category, what is a perfect modulus over this low triangle, low triangular algebra. That's all. And what kind of property we have here? So the DG category give some kind of, at first we can ask when it's a derived non-commutative scheme, because I have a special definition here that it should be cohomologically bounded, and it's exactly equivalent to the case when T has only finitely many non-trivial cohomologies. So in this situation, low triangle DG algebra will be cohomologically bounded. And after that, we get a new derived non-commutative scheme. And now the property what we have that if we consider triangulated category of perfect modulus over this low triangle, then we have a semi-orthogonal decomposition actually in such form. So we have two subcategories here that are admissible subcategories here. So admissible means that inclusion functor has a right and left adjoint. And we have a such semi-orthogonal decomposition. So the first part is exactly perfect modules over R, and the second part is a perfect module over S. And whereas T here, T is exactly the glue. So I mean that component are related to R and S, but how they're related to each other, I mean that we have a non-trivial form from object of from the R to the object from the perfect of S. And of course, this form depends on T. So, and moreover, again, so if we have inverse, so if you have a semi-orthogonal decomposition, then it induces any kind of semi-orthogonal decomposition is induced by a glue. So, what we have? Suppose we have some DG algebra E, and suppose that there is a semi-orthogonal decomposition of the category of perfect modules over E, A and B. So, then this category perfect modules over E can be obtained as a gluing of two actually DG categories, and moreover these two DG categories, they are directly related of course with components. It's exactly the DG categories that have the same objects. A has the same object as A, B has the same object as B, and all two such DG categories has a form perf R and perf S. And the perf E is actually quasi-equivalent to DG category of perfect modules over a low triangle DG algebra NTS. So it's very important notion here. And of course, what I want to say here is that, of course, if you have just a two commutative scheme and consider some kind of gluing, the gluing will be definitely, in general, derived non-commutative scheme that is not a commutative at all. Some properties of gluing. So gluing, of course, inherits a lot of properties of its component, but of course, we sometimes have to ask some properties also about DG by model T that is called glue here. So it says that glue should be good enough. And what kind of properties we have? So at first, when the gluing is proper, it's easy to see it's directly. So it's a proper if and only if X and Y are proper and T is cohomologically finite. So this means that has a finite many cohomologies and all cohomologies are finite. And it's easy. So, and another property when gluing is smooth, it's some kind of theorem again, Lunds and Schnurrer, and smooth if and only if X and Y are smooth and T is a perfect bimodal, perfect here is important. So, and it's nice to have such properties, such equivalences. And now what we have more. So what about finite dimensional DG algebras? Suppose that we have two finite dimensional DG algebras, R and S, and T be perfect bimodal. And let us consider the gluing. That it can be shown that actually gluing in this case is quasi-isomorphic to also finite dimensional differential gradient algebra. But perfect bimodal, it's important here. And there is example. The examples due to Sasha Yefimov. Its examples is actually related to some counterexamples to Kantsevich conjecture. Anyway, so, but its example exactly is give a counterexample to another thing. So there is example of gluing of finite dimensional differential gradient algebras with respect to cohomologically finite bimodal. So that the resulting DG algebra is not quasi-isomorphic to a finite dimensional DG algebra. So this means that this gluing, why it's not maybe strange, but I mean that it's important to understand that the gluing, such gluing will be proper by this property, that because it's a finite dimensional, cohomologically finite. So the gluing is proper, But this gluing is not quasi-isomorphic to finite-dimensional differential gradient algebra, and it's important to understand. But if T is perfect, it works, and it's a finite dimensional. And also, if the components are smooth, so suppose inverse R and S smooth, finite-dimensional DG algebras, and T is cohomologically finite by model, then again, gluing is smooth and also quasi-isomorphic to a finite dimensional differential gradient algebra. So here works that R and S are smooth. And of course, what we have here, so it's just, we can apply this proposition before, just to show that T in this case, it's a perfect actually by model. And what kind of corollary we have? So let R be a differential gradient algebra. And suppose that category of perfect modules over R is proper and has a full semi-exceptional collection, but also this collection, I didn't say that its collection is separable. What means separable? Sorry, I return back, again back. So I didn't say here that semi-exceptional collection it's also I forgot to say here that it's a semi-exceptional collection is called separable if all semi-simple, if any object is separable, so all semi-simple algebras are separable. What this means? This means that so any semi-simple algebra is just a product of matrix algebra over division algebras, and division algebras are separable if center, that is a finite extension of our base field K, is separable extension. So it's a, this means that the center of division algebra is a separable extension of our base field K. And what I want to say here that in this situation, suppose R is such DG algebra that category has a full separable semi-exceptional collection, then R is smooth and quasi-isomorphic to a finite dimensional differential gradient algebra. So smooth because it's a gluing of smooth part, and it's important here that these are separable semi-simple algebras because it's exactly when semi-simple algebras are smooth. And after that, it works with theorem proposition, and this gives us that it's actually R is also smooth and quasi-isomorphic to finite dimensional differential gradient algebras. Let's go further. So, and what about finite dimensional differential gradient algebras now? So, what we want? Let us consider finite dimensional differential gradient algebra, and let now denote by R underline the underlying ungraded algebra of R. So it's just a usual finite dimensional algebra, not graded. So after that, we can consider the radical, the Jacobson radical of this algebra. It's a usual thing. And what we want to understand how it's what we can say about this radical in terms of differential gradient algebra. So at first, now of course we know that it's nilpotent for some n, n is called index of nilpotency, and the radical, at first we can say that radical is a gradient ideal. It was known, it's not difficult anyway, so it's G is universal, so it's not surprised, so that it's also the gradient ideal. But what about differential? On the other hand, the radical is not necessarily a differential gradient ideal. So what I mean? I mean that D is not necessary if we consider action of differential D, it's not actually, I mean that G is not invariant with respect to action of D. And it's a problem that can be, it should be resolved actually. And what is how we can resolve this problem? So let us consider general things. So let us consider graded two-sided ideal here. And let us define two differential gradient ideals that related to I. The first is internal differential gradient ideal. It's just is a sub-ideal of I that consists of all such elements of I that are such that the differential is also belongs to I. That's all. And also we can consider external differential gradient ideal E plus. That is just a sum of I and if we apply differential to I, it can be checked that it's actually two-side ideal. And of course it's, that it's closed on the action of differential. And the main thing here that it maybe looks strange, but it's an absolutely simple lemma, just a two sentence for proof, that the natural isomorphism. So we have gradient to side ideal I. Then we can consider internal and external. And of course, internal, it's a sub ideal of I, while external, it's contained I. So now we have a natural homomorphism of the DG algebras, so looks, because all of them are DG ideals, so these quotients are DG algebras, and we have a natural morphism. And this morphism is actually quasi-isomorphism. It's an important thing here. So, and DG ideals, G minus and G plus, are called internal and external DG radicals of R. So, and useful properties of these internal and external differential gradient radicals, the useful properties are following. So the first, the useful property of G minus, that is, it is important. It's important for us. But useful property of G plus, that the quotient algebra of R by G plus is semi-simple as a usual algebra. As a usual algebra, it's a semi-simple because G plus contains contains radical G, so this means that this is a quotient of the semi-simple algebra. It's also semi-simple. So, and how we apply these things here? So now we have to talk about semi-simple finite-dimensional differential gradient algebras and what is the definition. So we have two definitions. So one is a factorial, that is natural. So DG algebra is called simple if the DG category perf S is quasi-equivalent to perf D, where D is just a finite-dimensional division algebra. That's all. And it's semi-simple if perf S is gluing of perf D1 and DM, where D1 and DM are division algebras. And it's called separable, so it's here, if all division algebras are separable over K. So this means, again, the centers are separable extensions of K. And another definition that is we need here, the abstractly semi-simple. So, DG algebra, differential gradient algebra S is called abstractly semi-simple if the underlying algebra, usual algebra, not gradient, underlying algebra, just a semi-simple. It's not invariant with respect to quasi-isomorphism, but we need it. And what we have, how they related to each other, this property, to be simple and to be abstractly simple. So, at first, any semi-simple differential gradient algebra, any semi-simple is quasi-isomorphic to abstractly semi-simple differential gradient algebra. It's easy because how it looks. So indeed, if you have any object in perf D, then differential gradient algebra of endomorphism is abstractly simple. And if our category, like here, is a quasi-equivalent to perf D, then differential gradient algebra S is quasi-isomorphic to some endomorphism of some object. So this means that it should be quasi-isomorphic to abstractly semi-simple differential gradient algebra. And important for us thing that also we can inverse this statement and say that suppose that we have an abstractly simple differential gradient algebra. So this algebra S is simple and some kind of differential. Then it is simple also as a DG algebra and it's isomorphic to endomorphism of a D, where D is some kind of division algebra for some perfect complex over D. So, and similar statement holds for abstractly semi-simple differential gradient algebras. And now what we obtained that all these differential gradient algebras, Rg plus and Rg minus, are semi-simple. Why? Because Rg plus is just abstractly semi-simple, because underlying algebra is semi-simple. So this means that this algebra by this proposition is semi-simple, but this differential gradient algebra is quasi-isomorphic to by lemma to Rg plus, so it's also semi-simple. It's exactly what we need. And now the Auslander construction. So what is Auslander construction? So we have a finite-dimensional differential gradient algebra. And let us consider radical G, and let us consider off powers of this radical GP. And for any such two-side ideal, we consider differential gradient ideal GP minus. And we obtain the chain of DG ideals J1, and so Gn is equal to zero. And finally, we can consider differential gradient modules of the following form. So it's a quotient of R by GP. P is one and two, from one to n. In particular, M1 is just a quotient of R by G minus, and Mn is just a quotient of R by zero. So it's exactly R. And what is the Auslander construction? Auslander construction is following. So let us consider the new differential gradient algebra. We denote it by E. And how looks this differential gradient algebra? It's endomorphisms of differential gradient module M over differential gradient algebra R, where M is just a sum of all these MP. And at first, what we see, we have a special differential gradient module Pn that is a home from M to Mn. It's just a direct sum, actually, of this E. This implies that it's homotopically projective as differential gradient modules. So it's a perfect, actually. And moreover, endomorphisms of this differential gradient module over E, it's exactly our differential algebra R. So the initial differential gradient. So this means that Pn can be considered as a differential gradient bimodule, and it induces two adjoint functors. So at first, the adjoint functor of tensoring with over R with Pn, it's a functor from dr to de, from derived category of all modules over R to derived category of all modules over E. And of course, a joint functor, that's R home from Pn to. And moreover, because Pn is a perfect, we have a functor on the level of the perfect category. So we have, of course, this functor is defined on the category, on the level of triangulated category of perfect modules. It's important here now. And now what properties we have? So the following theorem allows us to describe the differential gradient category of perfect modules over E and relation between differential gradient category of perfect modules over E and perfect modules over R. So at first, theorem. So it's a main theorem, it's exactly Auslander construction. Why we need Auslander construction and what we obtain. So let R be any kind of finite dimensional differential gradient algebra of nilpotency N. And let E be as above. Then we have the following. At first, these functors from the perfect modules over R to perfect modules over E, or from derived category of all modules to the derived category of all modules over E, are fully faithful. It's just embedding. So we get embedding of perfect modules of R to perfect modules of E. By why it's important for us? Because E is much better than R. It's much better than R. So what we have? The category of perfect modules over E has a full semi-exceptional collection. It's exactly why it's better. It has a full semi-exceptional collection. And also, if semi-simple part is separable, then differential gradient algebra E is smooth, actually. So R is not necessarily smooth, but E is smooth every time. And finally, suppose R was smooth, then the perfect modules over R is admissible subcategory in perfect models of E. So this means that we have some kind of semi-orthogonal decomposition of perfect models over E, such that one part is perfect models over R, and another part is some kind of orthogonal complement. So, and if you consider this R and E as a proper derived noncommutative schemes, then of course this functor is just we by model PN give morphisms from Y to X, and Y that is related to E smooth, and morphism can be considered as a resolution of singularities of X if X is not smooth, for example. And the following corollary provide a complete characterization. So of all derived non-commutative schemes of such form where R is a finite dimensional differential gradient algebra with separable semi-simple part. So the corollary is following. Let A be a small k linear DG category. The following properties are equivalent. The first, A is exactly the perfect DG category of perfect models over R, where R is a finite dimensional differential gradient algebra for which semi-simple part is separable. And this property is equivalent another. A is quasi-equivalent to a full differential gradient subcategory C of a pre-triangulated K-linear differential gradient category B, such that the homotopy category of B is proper idempotent complete triangulated category with full separable semi-exceptional collection, and homotopy subcategory of C is idempotent complete triangulated subcategory admitting a classical generator. So, and moreover, if differential gradient algebra R is smooth, R is smooth if and only if this homotopy category of C is admissible as a subcategory of homotopy category of B. So this give us a characterization, complete characterization of all derived non-commutative schemes that are related to finite dimensional differential gradient algebra. So this means that any such scheme is just can be obtained. So we have to consider category with a full semi-exceptional collection. So it's just a gluing of semi-simple parts, just a gluing of semi-simple parts, and any category that are related to finite dimension differential gradient algebra can be obtained as a full subcategory in such in such gluing. And moreover, any kind of full subcategory that are idempotent complete and we have a classical generator can be give us an example of derived non-commutative scheme for finite dimensional differential gradient algebra. So few words here. So what it means idempotent complete? It means that it contains all kernels of all projectors and classically generates classically generates triangulated category is the smallest idempotent complete full triangulated subcategory of T, which contains coincides with the whole T. So, and of course, there are some kind of subcategories that not admitting a classical generator. Some simplest example, if you take, for example, say projective line and consider the subcategory of torsion free of torsion shifts, subcategory of objects cohomology of torsion or so on that is not generated by a finite number of objects, so it doesn't have a classical generator. What we corollary we have? Let R be a smooth finite dimensional differential gradient algebra, then Grothendieck group of perfect modules, just a free abelian group of finite rank R. And because it's just a direct summand of, because it's admissible in the category with a full exceptional collection, and the category with a full semi-exceptional collection, it's a Grothendieck group is a free abelian group. It's just a direct sum of free abelian groups, so it should be also free abelian group of finite rank. And the important thing here, I don't know how to calculate it R. So the main question actually to find R here. I don't know how to do it. And now about geometric realizations. What is geometric realizations? So geometric realization for direct non-commutative scheme X is a usual commutative scheme Z and localizing subcategory in the category L in the category of all quasi-coherent shifts on Z. Localizing means that closed after taking all direct sums. Such that the natural enhancement of this subcategory is exactly the quasi-equivalent to semi-free modules over R. So most important class of geometric realization is just such quasi-functor on the when there is a such kind of embedding on the level of perfect modules. So this means that if we have some kind of quasi-functor between DG category of perfect modules over R and perfect modules, perfect complexes on Z, such that on the level of triangulated category, we have a full embedding. So this functor is fully faithful. It's important, it's most important class of geometric realizations. So this means that we can embed our derived non-commutative scheme in the geometry. So we can embed in the perfect complexes of a usual commutative scheme Z. So let X and Y be two usual irreducible smooth projective schemes. And suppose and E some kind of perfect bimodal, so it's a perfect object on the product X and Y, and we can consider the gluing of these two categories. And as I said before, this gluing give us a some kind of derived non-commutative scheme that is not necessarily commutative. So the derived non-commutative Z is smooth, because X and Y is smooth and E is perfect and proper if X and Y is proper. They are projective actually. But it's not equivalent to usual commutative scheme in general. But it's natural to ask about geometric realization of such gluing, and there is an answer. So there is a theorem that any such Z have a geometric realization actually. So there is a usual smooth projective scheme and there is embedding of perfect modules over Z to the perfect modules over usual smooth projective scheme V. And the proof is constructive, and moreover, we can say that actually V has a semi-orthogonal decomposition where all components are just a category of the following four types. It's just a field or a perfect complexes over X or a perfect complexes over Y or a perfect complexes on the products and X and Y. This theorem can extend it to the case of geometric smooth proper derived non-commutative schemes. So geometric smooth proper derived non-commutative schemes, it's by definition, it's such subcategories, DG subcategories in perfect complexes of X, where X is just a smooth projective scheme, such that the homotopy category is admissible in perfect complexes on X. And of course, if we consider any gluing of any such scheme, then with respect to a perfect bimodal, then we also can apply the theorem above. We can show that any such gluing also has a geometric realizations in smooth projective scheme P. And applying this theorem and this construction to the R and to Auslander DG algebra E, we obtain the following theorem. So let R be a finite dimensional differential gradient algebra with a separable semi-simple part. Then there are a smooth projective scheme Z, usual, and E is a perfect complex on Z, such that endomorphisms of this perfect complex over in this DGK category Z is quasi-isomorphic to our initial algebra R. And it is the same, actually, the second is the same as the first, that perfect bimodules over R is quasi-equivalent to full DG subcategory in the category, in DG category of perfect modules over Z. And actually, the Z also special, that it's not only smooth projective scheme, but the perfect perfect complex over Z triangulated category has a full separable semi-exceptional collection. And moreover, if R is smooth, that again, this category is admissible, homotopy category is admissible in the triangulated category perfect modules over Z. And just some small remarks that if K is algebraically closed, then actually Z can be obtained as a Taura projective bundles. So Taura projective bundles means that we start from point, after that it's projective space, after that it's just projectivization of vector bundles of the previous previous guy. And of course, in this situation, category triangulated category of perfect complex over Z has a full exceptional collection. And the following column will give a description of derived non-commutative schemes for finite dimensional differential gradient algebras with separable semi-simple path in geometric terms. So the same corollary as above we have, but only in geometric context. So let there be a small k-linear DG category. The following properties are equivalent. So at first, this category is exactly the category of perfect modules over R, where R is a finite dimensional differential gradient algebra with a separable semi-simple path. And second, A is equivalent to a full differential gradient subcategory C in the differential gradient category perf Z, where Z is a smooth projective scheme with a full separable semi-exceptional collection. So now it's everything is geometric. So I mean that Z, we embed in geometry. Z is just the usual smooth projective scheme with a full separable semi-exceptional collection. And of course, subcategory should be idempotent complete triangulated subcategory with a classical generator. And moreover, if R is smooth, if and only if this again subcategory is admissible as above. And again, if K is algebraically closed, then Z can be taken as a tower of projective bundles actually. And in this case, category has not a semi-exceptional but full exceptional collection. So, and finally, just two examples. Briefly, so the first example, let us consider just a usual exterior algebra, but degree of V is not an algebra, it's a differential gradient because V has a degree one, but differential is zero. So now we can consider what is Auslander construction actually gives if you consider algebra R, so this exterior algebra, we obtain that actually if we apply Auslander construction, then the category E, the algebra E and the category of perfect modules over E is actually the category of perfect modules on the projective space of dimension N. And the functor sends that R to the structure shift of the point, of a point on this projective space. And another example, consider the differential gradient algebra Kx by Xn, also is zero differential and also degree X is one. So if N is equal to one, then it's exactly the exterior algebra when V has a dimension one. But this is but for bigger N, it's another differential gradient algebra. And applying the Auslander construction to this differential gradient category, differential gradient algebra R, we obtain differential gradient perf E, algebra E and perf E, and this differential gradient category of perfect modules over E is actually quasi-equivalent to perfect modules over the PES algebra of the following quiver. So it's a following quiver. So we have N vertices, two arrows between any two vertices and such relations. So composition of A and B is zero. And this quiver Of course, it can be constructed some kind of geometric realization of this mirror, but I would like to say that there is a mirror counterpart to geometric realization that I discussed. So not algebraic geometric realization, but symplectic geometric realization. So this means that actually this quiver appears as a directed Foucault-Zeidel category of the special Landau-Ginzburg model, with a super, such that the total space is a hyperelliptic curve, and superpotential is just a double covering of C over A1. So it's not hyperelliptic curve, it's a hyperelliptic curve without one or two points. It depends on what we have on infinity. So, and if you consider such Landau-Ginzburg model, then Foucault-Zeidel category will be exactly exactly this quiver. So we are there. So in some kind of geometric realization on in symplectic geometry. So thank you very much. I will stop here.
All right. Thank you very much, Dima. Any questions? So this is an open hyperelliptic curve that you are proposing?
Yes, yes, because it's a double covering of a fine line. So of course, there is something on infinity. So it's an open hyperelliptic curve. So yes.
Minus 2 points?
It depends. So it's can be 1 point or 2 points on infinity. So so it's a genus G, and it depends. So you can consider different things. So it's a concept, and you obtain different quivers. So.
Other questions?
So can he? Maybe it's not the relevant question, but can he? How can I say, by using your technique? Can he? How can I say? So when I have two embedding of, so let me say that when X1 is embedded in derived category of X1 is embedded into derived category of X, Y1 and derived category of X2 is embedded into derived category of Y2, then these kind of gluing, can I have something like geometric embedding of this X1 derived category of X1 gluing by derived category X2 into derived category Y1 gluing Y2, and can I say some kind of control geometry in both
sides?
No,
I mean that you have embedding to the different and to the different varieties, and after that you consider the gluing. You also have embedding to the gluing of these different varieties, but the gluing of two varieties is not a variety, it's non-commutative scheme. So after that you have to, so it's exactly the main part, main theorem, it's how to embed gluing of two schemes to another scheme.
Yes, 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 yes.
Yes, I mean that because gluing of two schemes, it's not a usual scheme. It's a derived non-commutative scheme, but after that, the main theorem, it's a construction, it's not simple construction, it's not simple proof of this theorem, how to construct the new variety and embedding of gluing of two varieties to the third variety. I know how to do it, and it's exactly the main part of my paper about this, but I mean that the construction is pretty sophisticated.
Oh, I see. I see. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. I see.
Other questions?
Yeah. It's the question about the semi-orthogonal decomposition of the gluing. You said that both subcategories are admissible, both of them.
Yes.
Always? Oh, okay.
No, I mean that, of course, when we consider gluing, you have a such that one category is admissible on one side, another category is admissible on the other side.
Okay, so you don't mean both of them?
Of course, this, what means semi-orthogonal decomposition? You have two parts, and such that one is admissible on one side, right side, another is the left side.
Yeah, yes. Okay, thank you. Yeah, yes, sorry, course, I was on misunderstanding. Yes, yes. Thanks.
All right, if there are no other questions, let's thank Dima again, and we'll proceed in 10 minutes with a talk by Sasha Efimov. Thank you, Dima.
Thank you very much.